Hopefully people saw the email that said that because of some questions with problem number four on the homework, we're going to put that off for a short, until Thursday. So today, I hope that we get through at least the first two of these. And so the first one is finishing up our discussion from last Thursday about photons and the way electrons absorb photons. The second is something called optogenetics, which is the thing that was on question four that I think gave people the most trouble, which is a method for observing brain activity. A method for changing brain activity. So a method for actually stimulating or inhibiting certain sets of neurons. Which may transition on into Thursday and a little bit too, we'll talk about some methodologies for observing brain activity and also methodologies for figuring out where things are, where proteins are in the brain, which is what immunohistochemistry is all about. All three, the second, third, and fourth of those all related to some of the homework questions that people had. So last time I had drew up a few diagrams that looked like this. When an electron is confined in some space, then it has sort of a resting state or a ground state or sort of minimum energy state that it can be at. And then it can't go, it never could get to like here. It's not allowed to just sort of collect a little bit extra energy and start moving a little bit faster. The electron is only allowed to exist at certain discrete energy states. That's where the quantum comes from in quantum mechanics, is that there are quantized, discrete, separate energy states that the electrons can exist in. If I try to give it enough energy to bump it up to here, it won't even respond to that. It doesn't care. That's not enough to get it to the next allowed state for it. But we can calculate the change in energy between the ground state and the first excited state. I put up the full equation last time. This h bar squared times k squared divided by 2m, and then k squared is n times pi over l. So if we substitute this in, then what we get is that the energy or the change in energy is some series of constants divided by the square of the length of the box. So how big is this area that it's confined to? And so if it's confined to a small area, then there's a big jump between the resting state and the first excited state. If it's confined in a larger area, if it has more space to move, then it can it can make smaller jumps up to the next excited states. What questions do people have now that you've had sort of the weekend to try to think through that a little bit about any of that? Okay, so so this is actually there was a mistake that I had last time when I tried to draw retinal by hand. I messed up and put the resting and the activated form backwards. This is cis retinal, which is when the rhodopsin molecules in your eye, when they are not excited by light, this is the way that this little pigment that lives inside the rhodopsin molecules looks. For those of you that haven't had organic chemistry, everywhere you see a little corner That's a carbon. There's hydrogens hanging off of it that we don't even bother to draw unless it's really necessary to be fully informative. And then these things are either double bonds or single bonds. So it's a series of double and single bonds. And essentially, the electrons exist in this state where they roam all along the length of this molecule. And then this little gamma symbol is supposed to represent a photon. And so if a photon that is the proper wavelength of light bumps into this, then it will excite some of the electrons. And then they could do a lot of things. That energy could be dissipated out as heat. That energy could be dissipated out as another photon. But in this case, the energy is used to convert this into a version like this, where it just switches around, it just sort of twists one of the sets of bonds in the molecule. So that's what the energy from the photon accomplishes. So I also mentioned last time that photons or light had there are a range of different frequencies or different wavelengths that light has. Radio, microwave, and infrared are all things that we can't see. In the range of about 400 or 500 nanometer wavelength up to about 400 or 500 nanometer wavelength over here up to about up to about 800 or 900 nanometer wavelength is visible light, and then there are ultraviolet and so on that are shorter wavelengths beyond that. So if we go back to our molecule here, and actually let me back up even further. Is that moving? There, to this. So this is a sort of idealized physical state where we imagine that the electron is completely contained within this space. And there is absolutely zero chance of it getting to the other side of whatever barriers we've created. In fact, no physical system is like that. And so I can draw this same box here, length equals 0.7 nanometers. So now instead of drawing the energy states in the box, I'll draw the electron and the wave function that it has in the box. So in a perfect situation where the energy barrier, the confinement of our electron is completely perfect to this box, then all of these equations hold true. And only if our box is 0.7 nanometers, then only a very deep blue violet photon, 450 nanometers, is going to excite our electron up to the next energy state. Let me pause there. What questions do people have about that so far? Okay, but reality is not like that. There's no such thing as an infinite barrier. And in fact, depending on what the surroundings are around our box, this box is going to have different degrees to which the electron can sort of travel outside of it and spend part of its time outside of the box. And so if we have a pretty strong barrier enclosing our electron, then we're going to get pretty close to this requirement for 2.1 electron volts, which is just a measurement of energy. We need that, and we're going to be pretty close to needing that much energy to excite it. If we put a weaker and weaker barrier around it, So if we have a very, very weak barrier, then it's as if our length gets longer. So a weak barrier or a permeable barrier acts like we're making L bigger. Which means we need a less energetic photon. Meaning that it has a longer wavelength. More on the red side of our spectrum here. Okay, so in fact, the size of the zone that the electron is allowed to roam in this molecule is about 0.7 nanometers. So in a perfect universe where it was completely confined, it would take a very deep blue photon or bordering on ultraviolet photon to excite it. But if we take this and model the way it would behave in a vacuum with nothing around it, then there's some then even with nothing around it, it actually has a reasonable chance of sort of getting out into the environment a little bit more. I made a mistake on that. Let me fix that before it gets confusing. So now our energy step gets smaller because our box is effectively bigger. And so now we need a longer wavelength or less energetic photon to kick it up. And remember, if we take this high energy photon here and try and shine that on this molecule when it's in a vacuum, it won't. It'll just pass right past it. Because in addition to the fact that we can't get it to this point because that's not enough, we also can't get it up here because that's also not an allowable state. The next allowable state is something like up here, and then they start getting a little closer together, like this and this. But if we try and give it enough of a kick with our photons to land between allowed states, then the electron just won't absorb the photon at all. And so the larger our effective box is, the redder the light that's going to be absorbed by this is. And that redder light then corresponds to lower energy photons. And so depending on our box size and how permeable the walls are, we're going to have different effects there. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
Did they jump one?
Sorry, can you say that a little louder?
Is there one thing that can jump one, distance with, like, let's say, a red light and then, like, two with a blue light?
Yeah, it's certainly possible. If we give it a photon that would take it all the way from here up to the second allowable state, then that would be absorbed too. And there are even a few things that get a little bit more complicated beyond that, but we'll skip those for now. Any photon that we give it, as long as it gets it to one of its allowed states, it can absorb that. But if it's a photon that tries to get it between allowed states, then it won't absorb it. Okay. So last class period, I asked you a couple questions, and I actually didn't write down the exact wording of them. But the basic ideas behind the questions were, first of all, as the permeability of the box of the protein. So we're not going to put this our cis retinal here doesn't exist in a vacuum when it's in a biological system. It's actually encased in a protein. So as the permeability of the protein and the parts of the protein that surround this pigment around this retinal changes. What happens to the wavelength of light that can be absorbed? That's something like what I asked the first time, right? Yeah, okay, and then question two was, ideas for ways to change our environment. Okay, so hopefully most of the groups or all of the groups still have their sheets from last time. So what are some ideas people, or what are some thoughts people had about this first question? As the permeability of the stuff around this, as it becomes more or less permeable to the electrons in there, in other words, as the electrons are more or less able to sort of expand themselves out into the surrounding environment, how does that affect the way that light is absorbed by our pigment? Anyone want to share what their groups came up with for this? Sure, yeah.
So, let me make sure I get this right. There's a lot of links up there.
Yeah.
So, as the permeability increases, that makes the box less, or the electron is less confined, so you need to put less energy in to excite it.
Yeah, so lower permeability, so we'll say that's less confined. And then just to be explicit about something, that means that L, yeah, our sort of effective L, is larger. Yeah, and then you said, what about the energy from there?
You need a smaller energy input.
Yeah.
Which gives you a longer wavelength,
less energy in our photon, because our energy in our photon has to exactly match the delta E between our ground state and our excited state. So that means longer wavelengths, so they'll get redder. Did other groups come up with something different? The same? Other things to add to this?
Isn't that as it becomes more permeable, right?
Yes. Aha. Somebody should have been raising their hand a second ago and is having something different. Yes, more permeable, right. So it says it becomes more permeable. So if we put something in there that sort of gives our electrons a little bit more freedom to expand beyond the physical structure of the molecule and spend a little bit more time spread out, then this happens and we eventually end up with needing redder photons to excite them. What about for less permeable? So if we confine our electrons more, if we put our electrons more tightly confined, all right. This is where I get to pick on people. Then Dylan, what did you all think for happening for this for less permeable and more confined electrons?
Less permeable and more confined electrons means a lower L effective.
Yeah. So now we have smaller box effectively. Yeah, so kind of go through the converse of all of these, and we end up with shorter wavelength, bluer light. So the point of all of this is that we can take the same exact chemical retinal, cis-retinal, that naturally absorbs photons, and after absorbing a photon of the proper wavelength, it will twist some of its one of its bonds to take a different shape. And then we can put this into a protein, and by changing the local environment around it a little bit, we can tweak a little bit what kinds of photons this same molecule will absorb. So if we have two different proteins that each have one of these molecules embedded in them, and in one protein the electrons in that molecule are tightly confined, then that same molecule is going to absorb blue light while embedded in protein A, which with tight confinement. And then when embedded in protein B, where the electrons are more loosely confined to that, it will absorb redder light. And so depending on, so as we design the protein that surrounds this, we can actually alter the way it absorbs light. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? All right, the second one I think was a fair bit harder, but I'm just curious to hear what ideas, what can we change about a protein that, and actually, yeah, there are a lot of things that we can change, but just sort of more in sort of spirit of brainstorming, what might you change about a protein and a change about the environment around the molecule? And actually, to help just a little bit with this, for those of you that have had modern bio or other biology classes, proteins are made up of amino acids. Some of the amino acids are fatty and hydrophobic, meaning that they don't have any sort of polarity to them. Some of them have polarity. Some of them some of them carry negative charges here. Some of them carry positive charges here. So as we're kind of playing around with our protein, what kinds of things might we want to play around with in the environment surrounding our pigment? Sure, yeah.
Change the temperature, either hotter or colder. Hotter will be more permeable.
Okay, sure, yeah. So change temperature. Actually, that's something that's... let me change the temperature. So as things get hotter, maybe the things are jiggling around more. There's going to be more space or more permeability. That works very well. It turns out that that's not so effective for doing biology experiments because living cells are very picky about the temperatures they're at. But that's certainly something that's definitely an effective way to change this. What else? Sure. Yeah. Changing the polarity. So yeah, and it's a little hard to predict, but this is actually I have almost as much chance of getting this wrong as I do getting right. But the cis retinal here is mostly nonpolar, so my prediction would be that if we put a lot of polar stuff around it, it would actually confine the electrons a little bit more. But that's a little hard to predict. But definitely changing the polarity of things, whether it's embedded in fat or embedded in water, that will affect the permeability. Similarly, if it's embedded in fatty amino acids like the one on the left, that will affect the permeability differently than if it's embedded in watery polar amino acids. Yeah, and then you had your hand up. Yeah.
I was going to say you could use positive charged amino acids to confine them, or negative charged, like glutamic acid or sorbic acid, to make it or the opposite. More confined with the negative ones.
Yeah, this is again something that's a little bit hard to predict, and things get there's a lot of trial and error that goes into this. But generally speaking, like Aaron said, I would expect that positive charges around it, because they attract our electrons, in the molecule. So if we have some positive charges, if we have some positive charges hanging around outside our box, then that's going to sort of pull the electrons a little bit more out of the box. And so therefore, probably, sometimes things get a little bit hard to predict, but probably will lead to an increase in our effective length. And then conversely, negative charges will repel the electrons in the molecule. Yeah. What other ideas did people come up with in their groups? Got to have at least a couple more ideas. Let's see. Madeline and Alyssa, were you in a group together? Do you remember what you all came up with?
He said three things.
Those are the three exact things that you came up with. All right. Let's see. Then I'll start picking on more people. How about you, Tessa? What did you all come up with?
Oh, yeah. Just change in polarity.
Okay. Change in polarity. All right. Cool. Any others? Sure. Yeah.
Could you try changing acidity?
Yeah, so acidity kind of relates to charge, but it also another definition of acidity has to do with sort of the oxidative potential around things, and so again, that gets a little hard for me to predict, but yeah, so changing oxidative potential. If you don't know what oxidative potential is, don't worry about it. And then I had
concentration.
Just like how physically, how close is that? What you mean?
Yeah. Like, yeah. Like whatever protein that you're working with, how much of it is? That
probably wouldn't make a difference, because if the proteins are swimming around in solution and they're this far apart or this far apart, the molecule that's embedded deep within the protein is going to be pretty insensitive to how close the neighboring protein is. The physical closeness of the amino acids certainly might help. Tight contact with the protein. Yeah, I mean, so it sounds like this list captures most of what people came up with. The main message to take from this is that as we're trying to figure out ways that we can start to probe the function of the nervous system, in other words, ways that we can start to alter neuronal activity and make neurons do things for us. There are ways to change light absorbing pigments' capacity to absorb different photons. And in fact, sort of taking an even bigger step back from this. When it gets closer to the exam, I'll give you some practice problems and things to play with this, so that it's clear what exactly I expect you to know. But even if a year from now or 5 years from now or whatever, you forget the exact relationship between the change in energy state and the size of the box, if you just remember that there are ways biochemically to manipulate proteins to change the way the pigment, the small molecule that's living inside them, behaves in terms of absorbing light, then that is going to be, for any of you that go on to do any sort of research or medical diagnostics or anything like that, physicists and biochemists are constantly developing new tools for assessing and imaging brain function and altering function of cells. And so understanding something about what the heck it is they're doing is why we've spent now a good hour and 20 minutes or so on this. So just to give you sort of a flavor for the things that people that you may in your future careers or something collaborate with, why they're doing it, what they're doing, what it all means. Yeah. So questions about any of this? Yes.
So I have a question about temperature.
Yeah.
The temperature, I think that describes the mass movement of molecular.
Right.
So how would that change the structure of?
Yeah. So it can be a subtle change, but within an individual molecule, if it's moving fast, a couple things happen. It can actually sort of start. It sort of like acts like this little rubber band that starts bending and stretching and bending and stretching. But as it gets hotter, it also sort of the average length of it gets a little bit longer. It's a small effect, but it is measurable. And actually, this will come back again. For this, I told you that it has to be exactly the right photon, and if the molecule is at near absolute zero, then that's true. If the molecule is totally frozen solid, then whatever environment's around it matters. But it has to. But then it only absorbs exactly one wavelength of light. In reality, since things are not at absolute zero and they're jiggling around a little bit, there's a distribution of wavelengths with a peak that they absorb, and that'll come up when we get back to vision as well. Yeah. Other questions about that? All right. So now on to how we use this to alter brain activity. So I mentioned back on the first day of class that that we're going to be, as we go through this class, discussing several scientific papers. And actually, later on, I'll send a link to a 30-minute discussion that I put up just as a video for people to reference, where I'm kind of describing in a little bit more detail how to approach a scientific paper. But for right now, there are four real core questions to be aware of, core ideas to be aware of when you approach any scientific paper. The first is, what is the question that they are asking? And what is their hypothesis? And the only thing for right now that I'll say about the hypothesis is a hypothesis is not a specific prediction for a specific measurement, but rather it's sort of a proposed idea for a general or principle in brain function. And so, for example, a hypothesis in the case that we're going to be talking about in just a minute might be that activation of a certain class of neurons enhances movement, or even more broadly, neurons are subdivided into classes that enhance and inhibit movement. And then we'll get to predictions, but before we get to predictions, we have to actually think about sort of the core methodology. So sort of broad, sort of medium, big picture ideas about what they're doing. Not necessarily like, you know, a single sentence that's going to capture everything that you're ever going to need to know about neuroscience, but a somewhat big picture idea of what they're looking into. The second and third are both things that fall into methods, but they're very easy to confuse, and a big emphasis for us for this class is going to be keeping them straight, and it can be very hard to do. So this is what I call the manipulation or comparison groups. Which is your sort of familiar control group, or sometimes control groups, versus your experimental group or groups. And sometimes it's a study where you're comparing some sort of like natural diversity. So you might be interested in how age affects certain types of memory. And so typically the way you're going to do that, unless you have a very, very long time to do the study, is to measure different groups of people at different ages and compare their performance on memory tasks. So in this case, you're not hitting somebody with an aging ray and making them get old in order to compare them before and after. You're just comparing two naturally different groups. In other cases, you will actually make a manipulation where you'll have some group that you'll either some group that you've already manipulated and some group that you've left alone, or sometimes it's even more powerful if you have a group that you measure, then you do some manipulation, then you measure again. In which case, it's sort of the same individual serve as both the control and the experimental, just before and after you fiddle around with them. But this is another way to look at this. Is it's sometimes called the independent variable. Whatever the thing you determine or control. And then next you have your measurement. So this is what you actually observe and usually quantify. So this might be how much food an animal eats, how many questions somebody gets right on a multiple choice test, how many times somebody goes to the bathroom in an hour, whatever it is that you're actually observing and measuring and quantifying. And in fact, sometimes, as we talk about different methods, sometimes the most interesting part of the methodology is the manipulation that you're doing. The most complicated and difficult to understand or interesting or novel or cool part of the experiment is in what you're manipulating, and the measurement is kind of a boring thing. And so people tend to focus in on the manipulation. Other times, the manipulation is fairly trivial, and the measurement is really where the cool stuff happens. And so in that case, people tend to focus in on the measurement. But in any experiment, you're going to have both of these. And we'll actually look at cases where there's sort of each of those are sort of the more cool or interesting or exciting part of the experiment. And then 4 is the results, what you actually get. What you get, and then maybe you do some analysis, taking an average and a standard deviation and doing some statistical comparison, and then ultimately link back to your hypothesis. Let me modify that a little bit. There's sort of a fourth step in here, which is your predicted results. So if your hypothesis is correct, and you do this manipulation, and you take this measurement, what do you expect to see? And then you actually take the measurements and see what you do see. So I guess there's five. As we get more involved throughout the semester, we're actually going to be a few more steps that we'll add into sort of how we approach scientific papers. But for right now, these are the ones to sort of think about and focus on. Okay, so questions about that? Okay, so who's heard of channel rhodopsin? Taken any of the neuroscience classes? Okay, so this is, I'm not going to spend a ton of time on it. Carl Dieseroth and a few other people designed it. It is a protein taken from algae. Just like rhodopsin in our eyes, it has this cisretinal hiding inside it. But unlike the rhodopsin in our eyes, instead of activating some chemical second messenger pathway, which we'll talk about when we get into vision, it opens a physical channel that lets positive ions in and excites a neuron. And I'll put up some videos, and we're going to spend a lot of time next week talking about what it means to excite or inhibit a neuron. But essentially, we can either turn on, with channel rhodopsin, we can turn on neurons. There's a cousin of channel rhodopsin called halorhodopsin that allows you to turn off neurons. Instead of opening a sodium channel that lets sodium come in, it opens a chloride channel that lets negative chloride ions come in, and that inhibits the neurons. Questions about that, for those, especially for those of you, since there's about a third of the class that hasn't heard of this before. Any questions about that? Okay, so the book describes in this box 1.3, I think it was, about channel rhodopsin. In the first chapters, they're talking about core methods for understanding and studying the nervous system. They talk about a particular kind of experiment where some neurons in the hypothalamus are altered to express channel rhodopsin. And so in this case, our manipulation is actually sort of two stages. Part one of our manipulation is to put channel rhodopsin in some neurons, and then part two of our manipulation is going to be to shine light on those neurons to activate them. So if we go through this, so for our question, our hypothesis is maybe neurons of type X in the hypothalamus lead to feeding, trigger the animal to get hungry. Our manipulation first put channel rhodopsin in those neurons. And then the second part of our manipulation is shine on blue light. In this case, the sort of cool part of their method is the channel rhodopsin. That's the more complicated thing. But they do still need to make a measurement. And they're not making, the measurement isn't the channel rhodopsin. What's the measurement that they're making here? It's the y-axis on this plot.
Here. The feeding.
Yeah, how much they eat. Right. Measurement. How much they eat. If their hypothesis were correct and activating these neurons caused feeding, then the expectation is that the experimental group eats more. And so we look at their results. And before they turn on their blue light, the animals are maybe not all that hungry, so nobody's eating. The blue in this case represent the controls that don't have channel rhodopsin expressed. And so they start eating a little bit. They sort of increase their food consumption over time, over the course of this 3 hours. But the ones that have channel rhodopsin, but these control animals don't seem to have any drastic change from the time before the channel rhodopsin is active to the time during. Whereas these other ones that have channel rhodopsin present, when we turn on the blue light, they start eating like crazy. And then when they turn it off, they stop eating. So that's exactly what we predicted. All right. Yes, thank you. Yeah.
I think this is a silly question, but for the controls, do they also have like the optical fiber and the electronics?
Yes. That's a great question, actually, and the answer is yes, they do. And that's. There's a possibility that shining a bunch of light might heat up the hypothalamus, and heating up the hypothalamus might make you hungry. So they want to do as close as they can. In fact, also for the controls, I think that for this, what they do is they use a virus to insert the channel rhodopsin into the genome. And for the controls, they're going to use the same virus, but without the channel rhodopsin gene. So they do the same surgery to inject a virus. The cells all get infected by a virus, so the infection isn't the problem. They express something, but in one case it's channel rhodopsin, in the other case it's an inert protein, and then they shine blue light on everybody. The best experimental design, you minimize the number of things that are different between the control and the experimental group. Good question. Yeah, other questions about that? Okay, so actually pause here for a second to I know for the homework assignment, a lot of people were unsure about question 4B, which was one of the channel rhodopsin questions. The question was essentially asking you, first of all, in 4A, what is channel rhodopsin? What does it do? And then in 4B, the question was, come up with some sort of outline for or basic kind of experiment that you might do to understand how some aspect of a neural circuit functions using channel rhodopsin. And it can be a completely bizarre hypothesis if you want it to. Maybe your hypothesis is that activating the visual cortex is going to cause rats to jump up and down 10 times and then clap their paws twice. And that's whatever you want to do as your hypothesis, as long as your experiment uses channel rhodopsin. And so then the idea would be, how would you use channel rhodopsin to test that hypothesis? And maybe you find out that activating the visual cortex doesn't cause 10 jumps and 2 claps, but that's fine.
That was question three. So question 4 was the network question.
Question 4 was, okay. I got confused about my own questions. Okay, let's skip ahead then. So we'll return to this a little bit more. One quick thing that I do want to point out, and we'll go over this pretty quickly just because we just finished with the physics. Thank you, Teresa. There's one experiment that, if you go on the sample blogs, Teresa and I had a little discussion about, and this was about two different types of channel rhodopsin. And what they did in this experiment is they had two different kinds of channel rhodopsin, one that's traditional channel rhodopsin that gets activated by blue light, and another that's this thing called RIA channel rhodopsin that gets activated by red light. One of my little pet peeves with this paper is that they made the cells that are expressing the blue absorbing channel rhodopsin red, and the cells that are expressing the red absorbing channel rhodopsin green. I have no idea why they did that. That is kind of just a stupid decision as far as I'm concerned, but that's what they did. Nonetheless, you can read a little bit more about this in the discussion that we had. But what they did is they put this red-shifted channel rhodopsin into one part of the brain that is known to connect to motor cortex, the touch-sensitive area. There's connections between your touch area touch-sensitive area and your motor cortex. And then another part of the brain, the thalamus, which is sort of deep, deep within the brain. It's this egg-shaped structure that's highlighted below on my wallpaper here. It lives right there in the middle. And it provides input to many, many areas of cortex. So they put the traditional blue-sensitive channel rhodopsin in the thalamus, the new red sensitive channel rhodopsin in the somatosensory cortex, and then they stimulated either simultaneously or at different intervals these two different kinds of channel rhodopsin. And the idea was to, so their manipulation is fairly complicated. They've infected one area of the brain with one type of channel rhodopsin, another area of the brain with another type of channel rhodopsin. Then they're shining one of two different, either blue or red, or simultaneously blue and red light in the motor cortex. And then their measurement is, how do the neurons respond to these two different inputs? Here, let me clear this out here. And so in order to measure, So I guess actually, first of all, before I get into the measurement, I went fairly quickly over that because I had my questions confused and I thought everyone was confused about channel rhodopsin. But anyway, I went fairly quickly over that. What questions do people have about the experimental manipulation, the two different kinds of channel rhodopsin that are sensitive to two different wavelengths of light that are different from each other because of these sorts of differences in the amino acid structure around the retinal that lives in them? What questions do people have about that? And then the shining of the light. Yes?
How did the two different viruses get
contained? So you drill a little hole in the mouse's skull after when it's anesthetized. You do brain surgery on the mouse. And then you just sort of, very precise measurements, but essentially just squirt a tiny little virus into this area of the brain, and the virus is unable to replicate itself. So unlike natural viruses, which infect cells and then make more viruses, and then the infection spreads and spreads and spreads, these viruses are engineered such that they still alter the genome by inserting genes, in this case the channel rhodopsin that you're interested in, into the neurons, but then they don't make more viruses, so it doesn't spread beyond the initial space that you've squirted the virus in. Great question, yeah. Yes?
Those two areas are connected to the same neurons.
That's actually part of what they're trying to investigate. And in fact, what they found is that there are some that there are some neurons that are receiving input from both of them. And this actually does lead back into a little bit the next question that we're going to get about neural circuits. But yeah.
And they're in the motor?
Yes, yeah. So we have our somatosensory cortex, and there's thousands of neurons there, and they send axons all over the place, and among the many places that they send axons are over here into our motor cortex. And so there are thousands of neurons here in our motor cortex as well, and then meanwhile there's also another brain area called our thalamus. The cells there aren't pyramidal shaped, they're sort of roundish. And so these cells might send their axon something like this and make projections like this. And so one of the things that they were trying to assess is whether there are cells. So we already knew that there's some connections between thalamus and motor cortex, some connections between somatosensory cortex and motor cortex. One of the questions is, are those totally distinct, right? Do some cells only get somatosensory input, and some cells only get thalamic input? Or are there some cells that combine and get both kinds of input? And in fact, one of the things that they found is that there are some neurons that they can record from where they see that either the blue light, which is activating the thalamic inputs, or the red light, which activates the somatosensory inputs, will cause the cell to change its membrane potential, will cause an electrical response in the neuron. Yeah. Other questions about that? So can I? No, I can't move that up. I want to leave that over there. So now for what we really are waiting for here. So we sort of have a sense. of this question four about electrical, using electrophysiology to record the activity of and the connectivity and so on between neurons. So, if you want to know what's going on with a neuron, and one of the things that they did in that paper is the one very common type of measurement, actually these can serve both as a measurement and a manipulation tool, is to put a little wire, which we call an electrode, into a neuron. And so let's say we've got three neurons, A, B, and C. And they're all sort of, but for now we'll just say they're close together. Maybe they're actually pretty far apart in the brain. Like over there, they're pretty far apart in the brain. The different neurons are pretty far apart in the brain. But we want to know, is there a connection, for example, actually let's even take cell A out of it for a second. Is there a connection between B and C? So we'll go into this in a lot more detail next week. But when a neuron gets a sufficient amount of positive charge inside, then that neuron will fire what we call an action potential. And then that will extend out through its structure called its axon. And then that will lead to the release of chemical neurotransmitters. At all of the cells that get input from it. And then that, in turn, will lead to some sort of electrical response. In those receiving cells. So right now we have electrodes stuck into cell B and cell C. And we have, at any moment in time, we can either choose to just leave our electrode alone and record whatever the cell is doing, or we can shoot electrical current in through our electrode. So for example, we can use our electrode to deliver a whole bunch of positive charge to cell B. And actually, one other side note that I'll make is that these can either excite the target, so make the target cell become more positive, or inhibit, making it become more negative, or there might not be a connection at all. So if we want to figure out what the connectivity is here, which of these cells are connected to who, one thing that we could do, for example, is shoot a bunch of positive charge into cell B, make it fire an action potential, and look in cell C. And so there are three possible things that we might see in cell C after we make cell B fire an action potential. So rather than me tell you, let's take 4 minutes and try and discuss with whoever's around you, 3 or 4 minutes, the three possible responses you might see in cell C after cell, after we made cell B fire an action potential. Is this is problem four now? That,
why were they using like different?
Because they wanted to be able to record, they wanted to be able to independently simulate two inputs at the same time.
And they were recording like neural electrodes in the
neural. In the motor cortex, just in, but they didn't have electrodes in somatosensory cortex or in thalamus. So they couldn't stimulate them electrically. Instead they had to stimulate them with the chamber
rods. So they're just recording in the motor cortex.
Right. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. Yeah. There were a few things, but basically that some cells get input from one, some cells get input from the other, some cells get input from nobody, some cells get input from both.
So,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay. We might. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so it sounds like things have quieted down a little bit. The question that I asked was, if we activate V, what are the possible observations? Like I said, we're going to go into cellular neuroscience in a lot more detail next week. when I say that a neuron gets excited, that means that it gets closer to the magic point where it's going to fire an action potential. But exciting a neuron doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to fire an action potential. It just means we're getting it closer to that. It usually takes 20 to 30 different neurons all simultaneously exciting one target to get it to actually fire an action potential, or maybe one input firing 30 or 40 times to get that target neuron to fire an action potential. Here we're just doing a single action potential in B, so our response in C is probably not going to be an action potential, but it might move a little closer, or it might move a little further away. Yeah?
This is just a side question, which might be beyond the scope of this scenario, but like, if we activate B, and it could depolarize one neuron, but then hyperpolarize another, right?
I'm going to say no for now. The cells are either excitatory or inhibitory. They either excite all of their targets or inhibit all of their targets. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
So a cell has spontaneous fire and rate of fire.
Some do, some don't.
Okay, but
yeah.
And if it doesn't fire it, how do you tell? Or I guess you're referring.
Yeah. For now we'll say most cells are quiet. That's actually probably false, but we'll just sort of stick with it for right now. Yeah.
So how can we tell if the cell's response is a direct connection from B to C, or if there's like D?
Yeah. So that sort of also relates to this issue where a single action potential in an individual cell is unlikely to make any other cell fire. So if there is some hypothetical B to D to C, D might get a little excited, but it's not going to fire, and so
it's
D won't connect. Right.
Okay.
Yeah. That's
The questions that I got about 4D, I think, stem from this. You have a network of four neurons, and you don't know which are connected to which.
Yeah.
And so when there's this slight change in voltage, if that's how you're thinking of it, versus if you're thinking of neurons firing as a result, Like, some people were trying to,
scenarios. Okay, right.
Now we're getting
I see. So, yeah, so for this, for the purpose of both right now and for question 4B, let's say that a single action potential in any one of these cells is never going to cause any other cell to fire an action potential. It'll just jiggle its membrane up or down a little bit. Okay, yeah, so that's useful.
B connects to C and C connects to A, for the purposes of this question anyway. So B might excite C a little bit.
Yeah.
But you don't have to worry for the next part of the question what C would do to A.
Yeah.
A connects back to B. Not going to propagate
that. Yeah. Well, actually, that's great. We'll work through it. We'll finish this and then work through that. But that's perfect. Thank you. Okay. So, possible observations. What might we see? So right now, just cell B and cell C. We made cell B fire an action potential. What might we see in terms of the electrical potential that we're recording in C? Sure. Yeah.
You either see no activity if they're not connected. You see.
Yeah, so I'll say more positive. So closer to threshold, but not firing. Or it might get more negative. So that means further away. And so if we see no change in C, then we've learned that these are cells are not connected. If we see if we see an increase in C, then we've actually kind of learned two things. One is that, kind of like Catherine was asking, neurons either always excite their target. A particular neuron is either always excitatory or always inhibitory. So we've learned both that B is an excitatory neuron and that it's connected to C. Here, if it inhibits C, then we've learned that B is an inhibitory neuron, and it, in particular, inhibits cell C. Questions about that? Yeah?
In this study, are they looking at single neurons or
populations? Well, so here, this is just all made up stuff. If we go back over to this case, what they did is they recorded one at a time from a bunch of different motor cortex neurons. And so this motor cortex neuron would only get activated when the somatosensory cortex was activated. This one gets activated either time. This one gets activated only when the thalamus was active. And maybe there are some cells in motor cortex that don't get input from either of them and never show a response in this study. In our sort of made-up scenario, we're recording from one neuron at a time and stimulating one neuron at a time.
Would you ever get a case where, like in that study, one of the neurons in motor cortex would only activate if they received input from both?
It might only fire an action potential if it receives input from both, because it takes more than one input to get it to fire. Some cells might actually be getting like five or six inputs from somatosensory cortex here. So because here we're not necessarily stimulating just one neuron. So that's a confound. But there are sometimes cells that do require simultaneously two different inputs from two different parts of the brain to fire action potentials. Yeah.
But not just to like fire an action potential, but to show any change. So like there's some sort of
pattern. No, I can't. Well. Probably, if you gave me some time, I could think of a reason, and probably there are some cases, but for this class, we'll just say no. Yeah.
So how do they know beforehand which neurons to record so that they are connected?
I just randomly picked them in motor cortex and started saying, okay, so what percentage of the neurons get input just from the thalamus? What percentage get input just from somatosensory cortex? What percentage get input from both? So just recorded from, I don't know, 100 randomly chosen neurons. Yeah. Okay. All right, cool. So, let's say that our observation was that this was an excitatory connection from cell B to cell C. It's an excitatory connection, but it is not strong enough to drive the B to C is excitatory. but not even close to enough to make C fire its own action potential. Okay, so, but now let's say we've got, instead of two electrodes, we've got three electrodes. So we've got an electrode in A, electrode in B, electrode in C. So there are a lot of different possibilities that we could do. So for example, one other thing we could do, maybe cell C sends a connection back to cell B, or maybe it doesn't. Sometimes neurons connect back to each other, back to their inputs. Sometimes they don't. So that might be one thing we'd be interested in. Also, we're curious what the heck A is doing in this. How is A connected up with these cells? So for the next 8 minutes, work through as a group with whoever you've got around you all of the different possible who you can stimulate and who you can record from and what are some possible scenarios. The exhaustive list of all of the possible scenarios is going to be quite large. But just say, sort of for imagine, say, OK, well, simulate A, record from B. Again, those are our three possibilities. Let's just imagine, pick one at random, and imagine that that's what's going on. Then move on to the next. And so sort of think about all of the different pairwise connections. That's our list of all the possibilities for any particular pair of connections. And so just pick one and sort of then imagine what the circuit might be. But very importantly, say what the observation is. So the manipulation is stimulate. For example, manipulation would be stimulate C. The observation, the measurement is record what happens in B. The observation might be that B doesn't do anything. So sort of make clear, you know, manipulation. Measurement is the recording, and then the observation is it goes up or down or does nothing. So for all of the possible connections, come up with some hypothetical connectivity network for these three neurons, and then at the end of class you'll turn that in along with the stuff from your group from last time involving the channel rhodopsin experiment. The electron in a box experiment and ideas that we talked about last time. So make sure everybody's names on both pieces of paper and turn those all in at the end of class.